My husband asked me today why I was whispering. I told him I was afraid Mark Zuckerberg was listening to us. He laughed, I laughed, Siri laughed, and Alexa laughed. But though our devices are listening to us, are we listening to each other? Or are we just listening in order to hear ourselves speak? Or are we listening in order to plan our response? Or perhaps for a lull in the conversation so that we can interrupt? And I'm speaking from the perspective of a lecturer, a teacher, someone who's used to having people listen to her all day long. It seems to me that authentic listening is a sorely neglected skill in society and especially in education. And it's a skill that can be better utilized to empower our students and make them into better listeners too. I was guilty, and sometimes am still guilty, of not listening properly. And I'm not alone. Research shows that although 85% of what we have learned through listening, we are distracted, preoccupied, or forgetful 75% of the time. However, a few years ago, I started training to be a volunteer on the National Rape Crisis Helpline, and I've been serving on the line for over 2 years. At first, it was difficult for me to apply what I had learned even to my service on the line. Suppressing our ego long enough to really listen to someone presents a formidable challenge. But when I started seeing the power that real listening can have, I actually began applying this newfound skill to other areas of my life, including my home life and my classroom. It was not easy. I too like listening to the most learned person in my classroom. But I have come to understand that transferring knowledge is not my primary role as an educator. Let's be honest. Anyone wanting to learn anything can simply go into the edX website and find any one of Harvard's or MIT's excellent courses in a myriad of subjects. Let's be even more honest. So much of that information can be found on YouTube, Wikipedia, SparkNote, Schmoop, or any other popular platform. So, if my knowledge and information, though acquired through blood, sweat, and tears, is not unique or special, what is my role as a teacher of future teachers? Perhaps to use that knowledge as a basis to empower my students to think, to express themselves, and to engage in meaningful discourse and interpretation. And to do that, sometimes I need to shut up and listen. But simply listening is not enough. We might need to engage in a kind of active listening. The listening used in care, counseling, and therapeutic situations, but sorely neglected in education. In fact, it was only when I crossed over into crisis counseling that I noticed how absent this seemingly simple and obvious skill is. We like to talk a lot in education about SEL, social emotional learning. But are we really walking the walk when it comes to applying these skills in our own classrooms? In a nutshell, an active listener, firstly, communicates to the speaker that they are completely attentive, using all their senses to the speaker's verbal and nonverbal cues. Secondly, the active speaker will paraphrase and reflect the emotion and content expressed or restate the speaker's words to show that they have understood the meaning. And they will do this, and this is really important, without judgment or criticism. In fact, they will validate and normalize the speaker's words. Finally, the listener will ask open or clarifying questions and allow for elaboration. Let's say a student says to me, "I don't understand the Shakespeare guy, and I find him boring too." I might say something like, So you're finding Shakespeare very challenging and also very tedious. And then I might add, you know, a lot of students feel the same way. Finally, I will ask, do you want to share with me a little bit about what specifically you're finding so difficult? Listening, paraphrasing, normalizing, no judgment, asking open questions. Now we can make some progress. As you might have understood from my example, I am a teacher of literature, and it's a field that I love and about which I am passionate. But often students arrive at the literature classroom with a bias against this discipline. They tell me they hate literature because in school they were dictated the one and only interpretation they were expected to write down for the test, and they were not allowed any active engagement with the text. I believe that listening to their responses, ideas, interpretations, questions, and yes, even criticisms of a text empowers them to become critical thinkers, articulate responses, and engage in meaningful discourse. But the listener gains so much too. The famous phrase taken from Talmudic and biblical sources says the following: Mikol melamdai heskalti v'mitalmidai yoter mikulam. From all my teachers I have learnt, but from my students the most. And I can honestly say that I have learnt a tremendous amount from my students' responses, discovering something new about a text in almost every class. Now, I'm not the first to talk about listening, but I do want to delve a little bit deeper into why it is such a simple yet powerful skill. I answer the phone on my helpline shift. Silence. I listen to the silence. Are you there? A broken voice asks. I reply in the affirmative. Please don't go, she says. I don't have the energy to talk today, but I need someone to listen. To listen to what, you may ask? And I would hazard the following answer: to listen to the vulnerability of every human being. You do not need to be a victim of rape or sexual assault to experience vulnerability, or what Brené Brown calls risk, uncertainty, and emotional exposure. Brown, in one of the most listened to TED Talks ever, explains that vulnerability is an essential and fundamental part of what it means to be human. And therefore, when we listen, really listen, to the vulnerability behind an answer, even in the most academic of situations, we are answering a human need for connection, understanding, and respect. And the listener exposes their vulnerability too, because they open themselves up to the possibility that they might change their minds. The good news is that you don't need an extensive course in order to start becoming a better listener. In fact, only 2% of the population has ever received any kind of formal training in listening. You can start with applying just a few of the following strategies. Pay attention, not to your phone. Do not interrupt. I know you want to. Suspend judgment. Paraphrase. Reflect feeling and content. Normalize and legitimize feeling and content. Ask open or clarifying, but not leading questions. And listen to what is not said. One of the most important lines and verses in the Jewish religion is Shema Yisrael, Hear, O Israel. the most fundamental statement of faith, the Lord is God, the Lord is one, is prefaced by the word Shema, hear, listen. In fact, this word appears 92 times in Deuteronomy alone. God is telling his people that before they can accept his sovereignty, before they can have a relationship as a prerequisite for a relationship, they should listen. And us too, in our relationships, with our families, our pupils, our students, their parents, and the openly vulnerable people in society, we too need to listen in order for our relationships to be solid. Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks, who recently passed away, may his memory be a blessing, and who appeared on the TED stage in 2017, said the following about listening. Listening alone bridges the abyss between soul and soul, self and other, I and the divine. You don't need an expensive or an extensive course, just an open heart and open ears. Thank you.